Because we needed a house that was a little more hospitable for a wheelchair. So we found one right across the street, and now here we are. Mm-hmm. And it's wonderful, and thank you. I learned bread making from my mom, Evelyn. And my mom, Evelyn, learned it from her mom, Mildred, who learned it from her mom, Carrie, who learned it from her mom, Melinda, probably. Bread making is never going to be obsolete. Mom's bread was so good. And she made bread a couple of times a week. She often had timed it so that it was coming out of the oven just as we were getting home from school in the small town in North Dakota where we lived until I was 10. We were 1 mile from the Canadian border. So you walked in the house and there's the smell of the bread and the taste, and it was wonderful. Those of you who make bread know that when the dough rises, you don't have time to get it into the pan right away, you can punch it down and then you let it rise again. You can do that a couple times, maybe 3 times. So sometimes, I was the sixth of nine kids, so mom had a lot of things keeping her busy. Sometimes the bread would be going into the oven just about the time the little ones had to go up to bed. But when that was happening, we did not go to sleep. I'm not saying we did every other week, but on those nights we did not go to sleep. Because when the bread came out of the oven, mom would call up the stairs and we'd come thundering down and we'd have the bread with the butter and maybe some honey or maybe some of mom's choked cherry jelly. It was so good. We didn't have much money. We very rarely had store-bought bread. We thought Wonder Bread was a real treat. but fresh bread, that was a royal feast. It was good for the body, good for the soul. When my kids were growing up, I made bread fairly often, not twice a week, maybe not always once a week. But when things were tough or money was a little tight and things felt stressed, I made a point of baking bread because it really makes you feel better. Bread cheers you up. In scripture, bread is honor. It's mentioned in Psalm 104, which is possibly my very favorite psalm. It's a creation song, and you start out, you're above the atmosphere, and there's the thunder and the lightning and the clouds and the light, and then you're swooping down into the world, and the mountains rise up, and the waters flow down, and then you're along a babbling brook, and the birds are singing in the branches. I love Psalm 104. And there it says, God causes grass to grow for the cattle, and plants for people to cultivate that they may bring forth food from the earth. Wine to gladden the heart, oil to make the face shine, and bread to sustain the heart. Bread gives us strength and bread gives us courage. Makes us feel better. Jesus knew this. He fed the 5,000 who had come to hear his teaching with bread and fish because he didn't want them to collapse on their way home. And Jesus tells us that he is our bread of life. He is our sustenance, he is our courage, he is our strength. And there are times in our life, that's always true, but there are times in our lives when we're more aware of death. And for me, one of those times started on a Sunday night in July, about 4.5 years ago. The phone rang at 9:30 at night. So 9:30 means either it's really a really good friend or something is wrong. So we had a landline. I still have a landline. I'm old school. My husband picked up the extension where he was before I got to the one closest to me. And I heard a man's voice saying, with the Brooklyn Center Police Department, we're at your son's house with the paramedics. That was nice of him to ease into it. Something was wrong. And he said, your son is non-responsive. No. I've lost people, and I know what that means. The officer was calling to see if there was a history of family medical problems or if David had a history of drug use, which he didn't, but they didn't believe us until all the toxicology reports came in. He was 29 years old. And when you go into cardiac arrest at 29, it's a pretty fair guess that it's a drug overdose. He had gone into cardiac arrest. It wasn't a heart attack. His muscles were fine, but the electrical system just kicked off. So he had just come back from taking a friend, Nicole, for a motorcycle ride, and felt a little bit funny, lay down on the couch, got up to go to the bathroom, and collapsed, stopped breathing. Nicole and his roommate, Tony, called 911, and then tried to do CPR as best they could, but they had to keep training back and forth. Tony still has flashbacks every time David coughs. Tony's like, he's back at bat knee. It was 20 minutes. Okay, the firefighters got there in 7 minutes, and 4 minutes later the ambulance was there. But it was 20 minutes from the time the 911 call was placed until the paramedics actually got his heart started again. So 20 minutes without oxygen, without much oxygen, and you're looking at some pretty serious brain damage. They took David to North Memorial. Doug and I got in the car. It was 4 miles from our house. We got in the car, got over there. I fully, fully expected that they would tell me he was dead when we got there. But David was not dead. Our daughter came, our friend Jean was there, our other friends Tony and Nicole, and we waited. They put David into a coma, hypothermic coma, where they cooled everything way down. The idea of that is to reduce any damage from brain inflammation. So, and then 2 days later, they started gradually warming him up again and waited for him to wake up. His eyes had opened, but his eyes were just fixed. He wasn't blinking. His eyes weren't moving. He was just staring. And his arms and legs started to pull in toward the center of his body like this. And they had told us about that. That's called posturing, and it generally indicates that there is very severe brain damage. So we saw all of that happening. I'd seen it before. 2 years earlier, maybe not quite two, my neighbor Dee had collapsed. She's younger than us. She was younger than myself. And I went to the hospital to see her, and it was that. It was the fixed eyes and the pulling in, and a few days later she died. And 35 years before that, my sister was 21 years old, just graduated from college, took her first plane ride to go down to Nebraska to interview for a job. The plane crashed in a field outside of Lincoln. There were 15 people on board. 12 of them were dead at the scene. Alita was taken to the hospital. And the next morning I got on a Greyhound bus and went down to Lincoln. My mom came. My older brother brought her. A sister came, and we sat in this hospital room and we waited for her to wake up. I learned bread making from my mom, but in that hospital room, I learned again from my mom what it looks like when you rely totally on Jesus as your bread of life, as your sustenance, as your courage, as your strength. She would say, "For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain." She said that many times in those few days. Quoting Paul in his letter to the Philippians. And that's the Bible verse that is on my sister's tombstone. So as we waited for David, I knew that people don't always get better. A neurosurgeon came, called me in the waiting room one morning. He said, he's vegetative. He said, "You need to talk about end-of-life decisions." Okay. But I didn't want to do that without Doug there. So later that day, we met with the hospital's general doctor. He said, he had MRI images on the computer screen for us, and most of the brain was grayed out, and he said, "David is gone." He said, "Whatever made David David isn't there anymore. All that's left are stem functions," he told us, "just breathing and respiratory," that's the same thing, "breathing and heartbeat, that's all that's left." Well, Peggy. Doug and I left the hospital and went home, drove home just in silence. We went into the house. He sat down in his recliner, I sat down on the couch. And Doug said, well, it looks like we lost our boy. And then I was just sitting on the arm of the recliner and holding him while he cried. It's the only time I've actually seen my husband totally overcome with grief. And that's what we thought was the end of the story for David. Well, the end of this part of the story. We know from the book of Job that we don't always get to know the answers. Probably hardly ever do we get to know the answers. We don't get to know the whys and the wherefores and the what-fors of life. Even though without the answers, we can look and see the beautiful things that God is doing, even in the middle of things like this. Oh, I don't have time to list them all. There's so much. But what we do know is that even when these things are happening, God is our bread, He is our life, He is our existence. This life isn't our whole story. This life is not our whole story. In everything, God is working for good. We know that His love for us is deeper and higher and wider than we can even comprehend. Always I come back to this. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. God took on human form for the purpose of dying so that He could destroy death from the inside out, just burst through it, and that way He gives us new life. He is our bread of life. So taste the bread and see that it is good.